Shabbat Shalom. Say that, say Shabbat Shalom. You say Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
And Sabbath peace, Sabbath blessings to all of you. I'm happy to be standing before you once more here at Hopeside. I thank God for another day of life that we can stand and we can breathe and we're able to hear, be here and worship freely. Right? There are some people have to hide in closets to worship God. But we can openly, freely worship Him. And I'm going to bring you back to Genesis today. So I thought, since this is Black History Month, I would start off with a presentation by James Weldon Johnson. Now, James Weldon Johnson is one of my favorite poets. How many of you are familiar with James Weldon Johnson? Anybody know? James Weldon Johnson wrote Lift Every Voice and Sing. He's the author of that song. Yeah. Now you learned them. James Weldon Johnson wrote Lift Every Voice and Sing. He wrote a book called God's Trombones. And from that book today, I'm going to recite to you one of his poems. A free verse. The Creation by James Weldon Johnson. And God stepped out on space and he looked around and said, I'm lonely. I'll make me a world as far as the eye of God could see. Darkness covered everything. Blacker than 100 midnights down in a cypress swamp. Then God smiled. And the light broke, and the darkness rolled up on one side, and the light stood shining on the other. And God reached out and took the light in his hands, and he rolled the light around in his hands until he made the sun. And he set that sun ablazing in the heavens. And the light that was left for making the sun, God gathered up in a shining ball and flowed against the darkness, spangling the night with the moon and the stars. Then down between the darkness and the light, he hurled the world. And God said, that's good. Then God walked. He saw his moon. He looked at the stars. He looked on his world that he had made. And as he walked, his footsteps hollowed the valleys out and bulged the mountains up. Then God stopped. He saw that the earth was hot and barren. So he stepped over to the edge of the world and spat out the seven seas. He batted his eyes and the lightnings flashed. He clapped his hands and the thunders roared. And the waters of the earth came down. The cooling waters came down. And then the little grass sprouted. The little red flowers blossomed. The pine tree pointed his finger to the sky. The oak spread out its arms. Then God smiled again. And the rainbow appeared and curled itself around his shoulder. And God said, that's good. Then God waved his hand. He raised his hand over the seas and over the land. And quicker than he could drop his hand, he said, bring forth! Bring forth! Beasts and birds, fish and fowl roamed the forest and the woods, swam the oceans, split the air with their wings. God said, that's good. Then God stepped down. He looked around, he looked at the world that he had made. He looked at the sun, he looked at the stars. look on his earth. And God said, I'm lonely still. So by the side of a hill, he sat down. By a deep, wide river, with his head in his hands, God thought and thought till he thought, I'll make me a man. Up from the bed of the river, God scooped the clay. And by the bank of the river, he kneeled him down. And there, the great God Almighty, who lit the sun and fixed it in the sky, who rounded the earth in the middle of his hands. This great God, like a mammy bending over her baby, kneeled down in the dust, toiling over a lump of clay, until he shaped it into his own image. Then into it he blew the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Amen. Amen. Creator God, Almighty God, our friend, our Savior, our Creator, we just praise you this morning for life. We praise you because you are God all by yourself. You are God. Hallelujah. And Lord, you made this day, and we rejoice in it. Lord, open our eyes to see you as creator of all good things, and help us to know the difference. In the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, amen. Amen. This morning's message is called Seeds of Deception. So today I will speak of literal seeds and also seeds as ideas. You know, you get a seed and people think of it, an idea. So two ways we're looking at seeds this morning. In Genesis 1, 11 through 13, it says, God said, let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants. What kind of plants?
Seed.
Let me hear it.
Seed-bearing
plants. And trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds. And it was so, and it was good. I find it interesting that in the Garden of Eden, eating got us in trouble. And eating is still getting us in trouble today. Getting us in trouble with overweight, disease, all kind of sickness because of eating. Now what word is in the middle of death? Eat. Are we eating ourselves to death? Our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Every morning I wake, I think of that. I said, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, a living sanctuary for you. Because my body is your temple. And I think if we think of that more often, we would consider what we put in our temple. Now, you know, if you drive up to a service station, you wouldn't ask the guy to put some junk gas in your car, would you? Your new car? Mm-hmm. Would you?
No.
But we put junk food in our temple. So you need to think. So this morning, we're going to look at what we put in our bodies and how much. So what we're going to look at, what and how much. All right? Now, the Bible warns us of gluttony. Proverbs 23. He even compares gluttony to drunkenness. And you know that business, we just think drinking is terrible. So God does too. He's putting drunkenness with gluttony, overeating. He said, for the drunkard and the glutton will come to poverty. Then Proverbs 23:2 says, put a knife to your throat if there be any given to appetite. Oh, that's serious. He said, if you are eating too much, you just put a knife to your throat. I said, wow, Lord. Now, in America, the servings are just too large. You go out and you get a dish this big for one person. It's just too much food. We eat until we are stuffed. Now, God has put a switch in our brains after 20 minutes to tell us we're full. Did you know that? There's a little thing up there that says, okay, you're full now. But what happens? Sometimes we eat so much and so fast that the alarm doesn't even work when we hear it. We've eaten so much food already. Or we ignore the switch because the food is so good. I'm just eating this because it's good. Or there's a blocking of this alarm. And we'll talk about that later. There's some additives that are being put in food that blocks that alarm. And we can't stop eating. We become addicted to food. Now, God has given us four basic health principles. And to remember them, there's the word new start. So every day we have a new start. Okay? Let's read. N is a what? Let's say it together. Nutrition. E, exercise. W, water. S, sunshine. T, temperance. A, air. R, rest. And T, trust in God. Now, if you look at these, see, God has given us four of them already. I mean, he's just given us these, water, sunshine, and air. But he said, look, I made you and with a great brain. So I want you to use your brain and make decisions to choose nutritious things, to exercise, to be temperate, we're talking about overeating, to get rest, go to bed, cut the TV off and go to bed, and trust in God. He said, those things I've given your brain to use to make those things happen. New start. That's just something touch your brain, help you remember 8 health principles. Now, so the next few months we'll be looking at each one of these principles. Today the emphasis is on nutrition or the food we eat. God wants us to be stewards of our body. Isn't our theme this month stewardship? Isn't it? Stewardship? We've been studying about stewardship. He wants us to be good stewards of our bodies, faithful and obedient to make good choices. Now, I know we know that God is in control of our lives. We don't know when we will die, but he does. So what I'm telling you today, I don't want you to feel guilty about it. I don't want you to feel scared or anything like that. I just want you to realize that God wants us to be in good health. And we can make that happen. We can't determine how long we'll live. But while we are living, can we have abundant life? That's what Jesus said. I come that you may have abundant life. so we can be healthy and not diseased. So God has made everything, and when he made food for us to eat, he put what in it? The food we eat, what he put in it?
Seeds.
So when I talked to my little five-year-olds when I was a teacher, I said, what do you think, what's the reason God put seeds in everything? Remember that course of joy? Why did he put seeds in everything? What's the answer? Yeah, what's the answer? Love. He wanted us to have more. You can plant those seeds and have more apples, more oranges, more cabbage, more lettuce. He wanted us to have plenty of food, never be out of food. So, what happened though is after the flood, the human world changed. God made this command, and most of us throw this one out. See, first he said, I give you every seed bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for what? Food. He thought that it was very good. And then, after the flood, he said, everything that lives and moves will be food for you. Just as I give you the green plants with seeds in it, I now give you everything. Now that scripture is amazing. But see, God knows our bodies. He knows what we need. And everybody that needs the same thing. There's a book called One Man's, Maybe Another Man's Poison. One Man's Food, Maybe Another Man's Poison. So what you eat may be poison to me. What you eat may be poison to her. God made us all so unique and so different. And he knew what we needed. So the point this morning is choosing the things that are good. And when God made the world, he said, what? It is good. So, what I want to look at this morning. Often we're so concerned about whether people are eating vegetables or whether they're eating veggie meat or whether they're eating what kind of meat. And I wonder, maybe perhaps our concern should be what is in the food that we are eating. And what is it doing to us? Is it food? Think about it. Some of the things we eat is not even food. God made food for us with seeds in it to be healthy. He made the animals a certain way to bring health to us. Is it food that God made? Now, this is where seeds of deception comes in. The world has become addicted to food. Everything that happens is centered around food. Birthday party, celebration, everything, right? We've taken the food God made for us and contaminated it with additives. Let's just look at a few things God made. Look at those apples. That green apple says, I eat me, and I will help you control your appetite. It has that gift in it. It's a green apple. An apple a day will keep the doctor away. That is a true statement. It is packed with so many nutrients. If we eat that apple every day, our bodies will know a difference. Food with seeds in it. Oh, have seeds in it. Did you know that the kiwi has more potassium than a banana? More vitamin C than an orange? Did you know that? Yes. So, seeds of deception. Let's just wait before we go. This is seeds of deception. Think about this. Have we been deceived into thinking that we can go to the store and buy any food, pray over it, and it will make us healthy. It'll be okay. See, God said we need to be wise. Are the seeds we're eating the seeds God originally made for us to eat? The research is showing us we have been deceived. And the food that is being produced through fraud and deceit for financial gain is harming our bodies, and we're getting sicker and sicker. The pharmaceuticals are killing us with drugs to combat the seeds of deception. Now, let's look at Proverbs 20 together. Okay. Proverbs 20 is not there. Okay, let's go back. Maybe I added that. Proverbs 20:17 says, food gained by deceit of fraud tastes sweet and is sweet to a man. But afterwards his mouth will be filled with gravel. Can you imagine how nasty that is? God made that contrast because he wanted us to think about food that's been gained by deceit. Just like sin, at first it may be sweet, but later the consequences bring despair. We are suffering from the consequences of greed in our world. Would you agree with that? Greed and deceit. So these seeds of deception come in many forms. Genetically modified organisms, fertilizer, sewage, sludge, contaminants, pesticides, herbicides, ionized, radiation, antibiotics, growth hormone, antifungal preservatives, all of these things are contaminants. Now, what I want to say, the world is becoming addicted to food. And this is the reason, it's not your fault. The people, what they're doing is putting additives in our food that stimulates our taste buds and says, eat more. You remember the Dorita commercial said, I bet you can't eat one? You've heard that commercial? They know why. They put monosodium glutamate in all of their chips. I won't say the brand. And that stimulates you, and it is addictive. It makes you eat more and more and more. Greed, so they can get more money and richer. So, let's look at some seeds of deception. GMO, let's read what that means. Genetically modified organisms. That's what GMO means. I want you to put that word, those three letters in your mind, because from this day on, I want you to look for non-GMO food. Now, since Obama, they are required to put that on the food. So it's gonna be there. It's gonna say whether it's non-GMO. If it doesn't say that, you know it's been genetically modified. Now, these are the amazing statistics. Before I do that, we ask the question, what is it doing to our body? See, I understand that our body doesn't know what GMO foods are. Put it in there, and the body goes, what is this? So the scientists are telling us, the ones that are against the GMOs, are saying that your body just wraps fat around it. You don't know what to do, you stick it over in a corner. You get tumors and fibers and cysts and all these things are happening in our bodies. Why? We're putting strange stuff in it and it doesn't know what to do with it. So it does wraps fat around it and causes big knots and bumps and whatnot. But what I want to do, this is a book called Seeds of Deception by Jeffrey Smith. I want everybody to buy this book. That's what gave me the idea for this title. But so that you won't say, well, she said, I want to read something in here that you hear me read from this book, and I just didn't make it up. It says, master plan, there's a master plan that has been crafted by corporations determined to control the world's food supply. They presented Monsanto with the steps and procedures needed to obtain a place of industry dominance in a world, now listen to this, this is the world they want us to have, in a world in which natural seeds will be virtually extinct. See the things God made for us with seeds in it? We want to get rid of that. And see these things that they are making, genetically modified foods, you have to buy it from them. The farmer has to buy it from them in order to grow. They can't plant seeds anymore. The seeds won't work. Isn't that amazing? Then it says here, I just want to read one more thing. It says, Jeffrey shows how a handful of corporations led by Monsanto, M-O-N-S-A-N-T-O, has used its enormous wealth, you know they're wealthy, billionaires, as well as intimidation and deception, to turn Americans into nutritional guinea pigs. They're just testing it out to see. They'll be our guinea pigs and see what happens here. And they know what it's doing to us. So natural seeds are going to be virtually extinct. Not by wisdom. I think about it, I say, God must smile at us. And he's so merciful. I'm so thankful he's in the healing business. Because, you know, we wouldn't make it without his healing power. And he's made our body so it wants to heal itself. That's what's awesome about our body. But he says, wisdom. And in here, I want to share with you, it's called Wisdom of the Geese. Now see, God made his creatures wise too. It says, there's a farmer in Illinois who's been planting soybeans on its 50-acre field for years. Unfortunately, he had a flock of soybean-eating geese that took up residence in a pond nearby. Geese, being creatures of habit, return to the same spot each year. You see that around here. The geese come back to the same little lake, right? Yeah. But this time, the geese ate only from a specific part of his field. There, as a result of their feasting, the beans grew only ankle high. They didn't grow very high. The geese, it seemed, were boycotting the other part of the field. The reason, the farmer had tried the genetically modified seed in one of his fields and not the other. The geese refused to eat from that thing. Now, is that wisdom from the geese or what? They know the difference. Another story here, the guy was talking about his pigs. He said he put GMO food in one trough and regular food in another, and they didn't touch the GMO. These pigs, they were wise. I mean, so, you know, we got more brain than a pig, than a goose, right? So I said, Lord, help us. Help us to really have that wisdom and protect ourselves and our families. So what do we need to do? We need to start reading labels. What did I say? Reading labels. We have to start reading labels. Get non-GMO food. So, I left that up there so if you wanted to copy those statistics. What do most vegetarians eat? Soy. 93% of the soy in the United States of America is GMO.
Now, I went online to check this out, to see if Worthington Foods, Kellogg's, Morningstar Farm, do they use GMO? Sorry to say, they do. Now, this research that I saw, I couldn't find the latest one. It was 2001. So let's pray, let's hope that they're wiser now. So check your food labels. They're required to put it on there. If it's non-GMO, it'll be on there. If they don't have it on there, you're still using GMO food. You can look online yourself. Don't take my word for it. But you want to be wise. Wise. Let's look at some other sources of GMOs. Dairy products, because what they put in, hormones. So now, they're labeling. You can go to Trader Joe's. I love Trader Joe's. They have all organic stuff, everything in there. There's non-GMO that has Trader Joe's name on it. And he puts this on his cheese, that the cows this cheese comes from have not been given BGH. That's what they'll have on there. That means bovine growth hormones. So look for that. Look on your cheese. And make sure it says there's no hormones in it. Otherwise, where's the hormones going? Into your body, making you sick. Food additives, enzymes, flavorings, and please, never from this day forward, take another sweetener. It's worse than sugar for you. Artificial sweeteners, worse than sugar. Even the honey is somewhat bad because they have been taking the pollen from genetically modified food. Isn't it crazy? This is how Monsanto wants the world to be, extinct of natural seeds. Meat, eggs, dairy products have GMO food. Now, vegetable. Now, the main ones that he talks about in this book is soy, corn, cottonseed, canola, soy flour, soy protein, soy. They've just destroyed it. So you have to make sure you look for non-GMO on the things you buy that have soy in it. Infant, children's formulas, salad dressing, hot dogs, yogurt, all of these things. We'll just move on. Some more seeds of deception. Stripped carbohydrates. What is a stripped carbohydrate? Sugar. Sugar everywhere. Did you know that Martin Salt had sugar in it? Almost everything has sugar. Sometimes they change the name. They call it dextrose, fructose. They kind of deceive you that, oh, there's no sugar in this. It's sugar. This statistic amazed me. The average American eats 140 pounds of sugar a year. And that's 173 grams per day. 40 teaspoons. Now you think, I didn't bring my teaspoon. I'm going to bring my teaspoon and put in 40 teaspoons in a glass. And you can see how much sugar that is. But one 12-ounce drink has 10 teaspoons of sugar in it. So, if you drink four, what happens? You have your 40 grams already there for the day. Because there are 4 grams in every teaspoon. So think of it, when you look at your yogurt containers, when you look at your beans, whatever it is, and look under sugar, it tells you how many grams. What are you going to look for? Grams, okay? So, if it says 4 grams, it's 4 grams in 1 teaspoon. 4. So maybe most of the yogurt says 16 grams. And that's how many teaspoons? 4, 8, 12. It's 4 teaspoons of sugar, and it's 6 ounces. Can you imagine putting 4 teaspoons of sugar in that amount of something? That's what you're eating. See, I don't want to be laborious on this, but I think if we don't talk about it, you don't think about, well, what am I supposed to look for? Look for the amount of sugar that they're putting in everything. They'll say, low fat. No fat. Oh, but they have to put something in it to make it taste good. So they put more sugar. They'll say, low salt. So they take out some salt and put some more sugar in it so it tastes good. High fructose corn syrup. So I'm giving you some letters here. GMO, genetically modified food. Okay, this is another one you want to look for. High fructose corn syrup. And most people think corn is good. Not anymore. Fructose is high sugar. So look for HFCs. Every ketchup bottle has high fructose corn syrup. It's amazing. I mean, you have to get organic. Trader Joe's or some health food store. Every bottle of ketchup has high fructose corn syrup. Sweet pickles, high fructose corn syrup. So the only alternative I suggest for sugar would be stevia, and that's a green made from a seed that God made. Stevia is good sweetener. MSG, okay, so I've told you GMOs, HFCs, high fructose corn syrup. What is HFC? What is GMO? Thank you. And now we're at MSG, monosodium glutamate. And they're putting this in everything because what does it do? Stimulates your taste buds so you can eat more. You become addicted to this food. It's in your pizzas, it's in your spaghetti, it's in everything. It is just amazing. So check out if it has most of the seasoned chips have MSG in them, unless it's organic. Too much alcohol is another problem. See, deception. People think, oh, it makes me feel good, so it must be good. Okay. Except salt, high saturated fats and foods. Vegetable oil used to be good. Mm-mm. Canola oil used to be good. Mm-mm. You have to look. If it doesn't say non-GMO, it's not. They've taken it over. Now, I mentioned organic food. That's one key. And some people say, well, I mean, that stuff is so high. But think about your temple. It's an investment in you. It's worth it. You feel better. The food tastes better. I can eat an apple now and tell the difference in an organic apple and one that's not organic. Because you can taste, after a while, when you're used to that purity, you can taste the pesticides and stuff in this food. Trust me. Organic means it's without pesticides, it's without synthetic fertilizers. You know, they used to use cow manure, you know. Not anymore. Synthetic fertilizers. Switch, use that. Non-GMO, that means that if you get organic food, it's without all of these things. Otherwise, these things are in the food. So, organic eggs, meat, poultry, dairy products do not have antibiotics and growth hormone. That's what you have to look for on the label. Is it without? They have to put it on there now. Is it without growth hormones? Is it without antibiotics? Because see, what big scientist's idea thought was, okay, if I can put some antibiotics in this stuff, I can make it last longer. Yeah, but what is it doing to us? What is it doing to them? So this is a number if you want to write down. Center for Food Safety. They give out little brochures. I called the lady and I said, can you give brochure. I have this little brochure that tells you about what non-GMO foods are. And she said they were moving and she had no idea in what box it was in. But you can go online, Center for Food Safety, or call that number and they'll send you information. So, my conclusion. There was trouble in the garden in the beginning. Accepting what God has given us as good But Eve was taught, and oh, you can eat that, that, accepting what God has given us is good. Accepting there's no need to change what he has made. And accepting that God loves us and knows what's best for us. He knows what's best. You believe that? He knows what's best. God loves us more than we could ever imagine. He loves you so much. And he wants you to be healthy, without pain. He wants you to be vigorous, be able to go out and share his message with everybody. If you're sick, you can't do that. If you're aching in pain, you can't do that. God wants us to be healthy. So what do we have to do? Make a decision. What will I put in my body today? Is it man-made or God-made? How much will I eat? Will I eat for strength or gluttony? Agatha Thrash wrote a book called Eat for Strength. And then in little words it says, not gluttony. That came from the Bible. That's the decisions we have to make. What's in the middle of the word death? Well, let's choose this one. Healthy. Heal thyself. God has made our bodies to heal itself. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you that you are an awesome God, that you are our creator, and our bodies are your temples. And Lord, today, for the rest of our lives, may we think about what we put into our temple. May we make good, wise choices, that we may be healthy, that we may have abundant life that Jesus wants us to have. Thank you. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Sister Athena, for the wonderful information and educational sermon, I would say. That should tell us just one thing. Do you know what that is? Of course, we have to put bad, which is good, but if we change what God made, we are changing what good is. Let's all rise and sing closing song, which is coming to us.
Right now, we're just going to bow our heads in prayer as we get ready to depart from God's holy place. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we just come right now before you just to say thank you for this gathering, just to strengthen our relationship with you, our desire for you, you know, just to strengthen us, oh God, in our walk with you, to be able to resist all the wiles and all of the trials and tribulations of this world. God, we thank you, Jesus, just for another moment just to come before you, just to get your strength and not to rely on our own strength. And God, to renew our covenant, our vows with you, God, and to show and prove to you, God, that we don't care about this world, God. We only care about you. And Lord God, I ask God that you will cover us, that you will guide us, that you will protect us, that you will lead us during this week, God, as we go, as we come and go, Lord God, in our decisions, that you will help us make the right godly decisions, make godly moves, Lord God, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Lord God, that you will, Lord God, shut down any incident, accident, Lord God, any death or anything, Lord God, that's contrary to your will, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And we just cover each and every one in your blood, and we ask God that you would send your angels just to surround everyone. And we thank you, we bless you, and it's in Jesus Christ's name we pray.